फ्रॉम बुद्धिज्म.
ओके, सो ऑल रिलीजन्स आर एटलीस्ट दिस थ्री आर इंटरलिंक्ड. ओके. हाँ.
यस सर.
नेक्स्ट. एनीथिंग एल्स? विशाल?
सर फ्रॉम हिंदुइज्म से एर्ली हिंदुइज्म थिंग्स लाइक मोक्ष रीबर्थ कर्म ऑल वर टेकन एंड बुद्धिज्म ऑल्सो टुक सम वैल्यूज विच वर एथिसाइज एंड non-violence, which was from Jainism in extreme forms, was diluted and put for in Buddhism in a diluted form. And there's this debate of rebirth, and two scientists have actually, in a scientific way, found out about the tried to find out about the theory of rebirth through memories of children. And yes,
how do you establish a case of rebirth?
Well, those scientists tested or say observed that in children of children of some age had some memories of their past life and which is peculiar that a small child cannot have. So interpolating that, they got the idea of rebirth, that this could have happened in his or her past.
Then verify that, only verifiability. It is not dreams. Finally, if they can be verified. Okay, basically verifiable memories, through verifiable memories of events or people which the child could not have known in any other way. These two things, child would not have known any other way, and they are true.
Sir, but when we were talking about this, I remember that story of Chakravyuh of Arjun telling his wife Abhimanyu. So I was thinking of this, if Abhimanyu could know this,
No, that is prenatal memories. Prenatal memories also are natal memories. They are called natal memories. Natal memories are reported. That's factually true. I mean, I'm not saying that Abhimanyu heard that way, that is a fiction, but the question is a natal memory possible? There are cases of like that. Child remembering what is happening within the womb. For example, one child, I read a book, Leslie book, one child asked the mother, Amma, why are you saying that I am a girl when I am a boy? So that the mother was asking, how do you know? Because this boy was overhearing the conversation between the mother and the doctor. Okay. And then boy also said, see, I was trying to come out, and why are you pushing me? Said, you are trying to come out in the wrong way. And so the doctor wanted to put, because the child was coming in a wrong way. So these are shocking natal memories. and prenatal memories also were reported. For example, a soul choosing a parent. So one boy said, "I chose you because I first saw you in Hawaii Islands, and you were there in that hotel, and you were playing in a beach." Things like that. And then I thought you would be a good mother. Wow. But these are extremely rare cases. But what this show is that there are possibilities, and prenatal and natal memories are investigated. Okay. Many may have, but most, in most cases, they are wiped out. They're wiped out. And also, many rebirth cases are the cases where the people met with an accident in a previous life, some kind of a traumatic event. Traumatic, if there is a traumatic death, it is more likely to be remembered. If it is a peaceful death, it is less likely to be remembered. So, and we also don't know how much time is there between the death and the rebirth. So that could be some cultural factors. Okay, but this is how investigation takes place. What does the child say, and how did he arrive at this information, and is that verifiable? So what the scientists are doing is only verifiability of what the child is saying. That's all. And then they list in terms of number of items, how many things he said which are verifiable. So he said, for example, 35 out of 35, 17 could be verified. Then okay, 17 out of 35, like that. They give certain numbers to each case. What are the independent facts they said? How many independent facts are verified? Many times they couldn't be verified because the child talks about, child won't remember the exact place and things like that. He just remembers certain events, but without knowing the place, where can one check? So many times not verified, but sometimes verified. When it is verified, they will say these are the facts. Verifiable facts. So this is how research on rebirth took place. Okay.
Next. Sir, I have a question from previous class. Sir, we have evidences of Buddhism, Jainism, and we now know that there was teachings given in Mahajanapadas. So do we have the similar evidence for Hinduism as well? Like, there was a Krishna and he was giving teachings the way we have.
No. Buddha is a historical figure. We don't have any evidence for Krishna or Rama, no.
So, in essence, they are mythical.
They are mythical. Probably Ramayana Mahabharata happened, going by archaeological evidence. Those dates and events can be matched. But there is no evidence for Krishna or Rama, nothing like that. They may be small people maybe at one time, we don't know, but they are largely stories. I don't think there is any evidence for Rama or that to say that he is born in Ayodhya and then exactly at that place is of course ridiculous. But Buddha is a historical figure. Mahavira is a historical figure. Krishna Rama came later, and then no evidence. There is archaeological evidence for Ramayana and Mahabharata. That is different from saying that there is evidence for a character. I mean, mostly some war may have happened. Some war between tribes. Okay. They are pastoralist basically. So what we see in a movie is highly amplified and decorated. Okay. So when Duryodhana was shocked by Mayasabha, it may have been a small building. Okay, so the whole thing, if it happened at all, maybe some minor event, embellished over centuries. But Buddha and Mahavira are historical figures. But their predecessors, there is no evidence for the predecessors. Buddha was claiming he was 25th and Tirtha and Mahavira 24th. There are some people mentioned, it seems there is no evidence. Some of them are not historical figures at all. Okay. So in India, that mythology, culture, religion, history, all mixed up. Okay. Any other question? Okay, now we'll get back to Ambedkar's Buddhism. Okay. Tell me, what did you understand from Ambedkar's Buddha? Do you think he's any Buddha remaining in Ambedkar's Buddha? What are the things that Ambedkar rejected and still he claims to be a Buddhist? What are the things that he rejected?
Sir, may I answer?
Please answer, Sunil. Most welcome.
Sir, Nirvana.
You are a Buddhist, right?
Yes, sir. Ambedkar Buddhist.
Please, you are Ambedkar Buddhist. You please give your give this article to informed people. So let them discuss.
Sir, now this article has given me so many questions. I'll definitely go and ask to all the gurus that we have.
Thank you. Thank you. Most welcome. Some are responding to my video. This part is made in the video also. Some are responding. Okay. But this is different because, I could write it because I worked so much on enlightenment. And recently I worked on these things like soul and things like that. That is how I could get the clarity. Okay, now tell me, what are the things that Ambedkar did not agree? And why does he think that he is a Buddhist?
Okay, so first of all, he rejected Nirvana.
Nirvana. But did he say, I am rejecting Nirvana?
He said he doesn't believe in desirelessness.
Exactly. He doesn't believe in desirelessness. That is true. So he believes that people shouldn't have greed. But let me ask you, do you need Buddha to tell us that we shouldn't be greedy? It's greed in a definitional sense is bad, isn't it? Somebody to say that desire is a problem is a revolutionary statement. But to say that greed is a problem, it's not a revolutionary statement. Anybody will say, because greed in a definitional sense is bad. Isn't it? The problem is that Ambedkar is full of desires, of course, desire for good things, to abolish caste system, to create a better society, all those things. We're not saying he's small. So he can't understand what is this desirelessness. He felt that religion is for action, like this. And desirelessness, what is desirelessness? Isn't it dullness? Okay. So he's right. Not that Ambedkar rejected Nirvana or Nibbana. But Ambedkar thought Nirvana means control over passions. It is not a kind of a state of mind. If it is a control over passions, how can realization be momentary? What did Buddha realize under a tree? If it is control over passions, suddenly you can't say he got the control over passions at that moment. No. There is some process is there. Extremely rare process. Buddha was not the last. But it is a tragedy that the social sciences are not paying attention. In history, you read all kinds of books, how Buddhism spread, ecological, materialist foundations, why that king did this, did that. And then questions like, what did he do? What did he say? The impact, where are those stupas built, viharas? But nothing on what that man may have said. So that is an extraordinary rare process. Something happened. So it is not that Buddha Ambedkar rejected Nirvana, but he thought it was simply control over passions. So he was not perturbed or bothered by this issue. Absence of greed. It is not absence of desire, but absence of greed and control over passions. So which means Buddha is nothing more than a good man. But that would be a great understatement. Actually, in Ambedkar writes Buddhism, you can't really prove that Ambedkar is better than Buddha. How will you prove? What does Buddha have which Ambedkar doesn't have? In fact, Ambedkar is more knowledgeable than Buddha. Ambedkar is scientific also. Buddha is unscientific. On what basis Ambedkar can say Buddha should be worshipped and not himself, not Ambedkar? In what sense Ambedkar is inferior to Buddha? Ask any Ambedkarite Buddhist in what sense Ambedkar is superior, inferior to Buddha. I don't think they have any answer.
Sir, again, what is the question?
In what sense Ambedkar is inferior to Buddha?
They are mostly equated.
Why equated? Ambedkar is superior because Buddha doesn't have those all kinds of silly beliefs. I mean, Ambedkar doesn't have silly beliefs, unlike Buddha has. And Ambedkar's message is not distorted, unlike Buddha's message. So why should anybody worship Buddha? Let us worship Ambedkar. Why unnecessarily Buddha? When you have a man who is greater than Buddha. So, in any temple, Ambedkar's statue should be big and maybe side by side some small statue of Buddha, if you want Buddha also. But usually, Buddha statue is big and small Ambedkar photo. There should be reversal. Ambedkar's statue should be big and Buddha in Ambedkar's like this. So, how can an Ambedkarite Buddhist explain how Ambedkar is inferior to Buddha at all? He is not inferior. In fact, Ambedkar is superior, going by Ambedkar's understanding of Buddhism. Because if you take away Nirvana from Buddha, there is nothing in it. There is nothing in Buddhism if you take away Nirvana. Absolutely nothing. It is simple code, moral code anybody could have said. Don't steal, don't lie, don't do that, don't do this. Anybody could have said. Why do you need Buddha for that? So, rejecting Nirvana is a very, very serious issue. Maybe it's unforgivable because you have contemporary evidence. Ramana Maharshi is one such person. And there are some people who recognized him to be different. For example, Gandhi knew. We talked about Narayan Guru. I don't know precisely about Narayan Guru, but I know a lot about Ramana Maharshi. So Gandhi had an idea that there are some enlightened people. Ramana Maharshi was there. So, Nirvana is not a unique event. Some people are getting it. Some people are experiencing something. So, Ambedkar didn't pay attention to that process. What is it? He was not perturbed, disturbed by that. So, rejection of Nirvana to me is more serious issue. Other things are matters of belief. Whether you believe in it or not is a different issue. But though there is an evidence from other fields, but that is a minor issue. To me, rejection of Nirvana, equating Nirvana as control of passions is the most serious problem with Ambedkarite Buddhism. Not soul and rebirth and karma. They are not important. In fact, Buddha himself says, don't agree with anything that you don't find in your own experience. So you can reject. If you reject karma, rebirth, and soul, Buddha won't be offended. Okay, fine. But denial of a state of a different functioning, if that is denied, there is no Buddhism in that. I find that is a very serious issue, not soul, rebirth, and karma. People used to think in terms of soul, rebirth, karma at that time, and now we don't think. Modern day people don't talk about soul, rebirth, and karma. I can't comment much on Sadhguru, but definitely he is a great person. When Sadhguru was asked about your previous birth, I don't want to talk about it because you will think, you will make fun of me. You will think I am doing all kinds of silly things. Not that he doesn't believe, but he thinks that talking about it will only make him an object of ridicule. So in modern communication, these are not there, soul, rebirth, and karma. But enlightenment is there. Transformation is there. So soul, rebirth, karma, you can say they were idioms, they were the ways to think at that time. But enlightenment is not. Enlightenment is ever recurring process. So many people have experienced it. So that is about Nirvana. Next, Sunil, what else do you want to say?
So they did not, he did not believe in rebirth, karma.
Rebirth, karma, and soul. That is very clearly understandable because modern science is not covering any of these things. Rebirth, karma, and soul. But then instead of saying that I didn't believe, he was saying that Buddha did not mean it. That is another problem. Okay. So tell me, what purpose does Ambedkar and Buddhism serve? So what did you understand about Marxism and Buddhism? I discussed Marxism and Buddhism. What is the main difference between Marxism and Buddhism?
Marxism takes into consideration external factors.
External factors, yes.
And Buddhism is something internal.
Internal factor. Marxism is about changing the society. Okay, and also Marx thought if man is what he is, it is because of the capitalism. So Marx is primarily thinking of problem as external and solution as external. Capitalism is the source of the problem and end capitalism and bring communism. That's the solution. Whereas Buddha is about desire is the problem and desirelessness is the solution. So Buddhism is about the internal. Marxism is about the external. But that is not to say Buddha is against changing the society. It's not like that. Buddha's primary concern is about the internal and not the external. Okay. So, so what did Ambedkar try to do? Basically, let us look at from Ambedkar's point of view. So Ambedkar's point of view, the soul, rebirth, heaven, hell, God, gone. So that's one. And then something like Nirvana, desirelessness. Why Ambedkar thinks difficult, pointless desire? According to Ambedkar, what is the purpose of religion? You can attempt that. Now leave the spirituality part. Now look at it, social part of religion. why did Ambedkar want this kind of Buddhism, and what is he trying to achieve? For example, think of Jyotiba Phule and what are the problems Phule faced and how Ambedkar was trying to overcome them. For example, did Ambedkar solve the problem that Phule tried and failed? Yes or no?
Yes, he did.
How?
New religion.
New religion. That is the issue. Because Phule was against Brahminism, against certain Hindu values, but he didn't know how to go about it. Same thing about Periyar also. They were critical of Brahminism, they didn't know how to handle it. Because Hindu religion plays a role in many aspects of life, be it birth ceremony, marriage ceremony, Upanayanam, festivals. So when you're rejecting Brahminism, are you still being a Hindu or not? These are the issues. And also remember, before Ambedkar took this extreme step, he tried all kinds of things like temple entry and many other things. Okay. But Ambedkar found that there is no hope. And after a long time, first he wanted to convert in 35 itself, but after 20 years, after he became a minister and wrote the constitution or involved in writing the constitution, then just before, few months before death, he did this. Okay. You can say he was fed up with Hinduism, which means what was he expecting from religion? He was expecting dignity, equality. Okay. Equality, liberty, fraternity. And he believed Hinduism was not going to provide. That is why there are many foreign scholars who looked into Ambedkar's Buddhism, looked at Ambedkar's Buddhism in a sympathetic way. Ambedkar was trying to meet the social needs of people, not much bothered about the spirituality and the supernaturality or metaphysics, not like that. What is the social context? This Hinduism, discrimination, untouchability, and people should live. I am born as a Hindu. I am not going to die as a Hindu. And it should give confidence to the people. But within the fold of Hinduism, he didn't know how to go about it. It's not easy. So he thought of a new thing. And when he thought of a new thing, what happens is that then all the traditions, the gods, temples, festivals, then they have all of them. Unlike in Phule's group, Satya Sodhak Samaj. So by going, and at the same time, why did he choose Buddhism? And probably because Buddhism won't be hostile to Hinduism, unlike Islam or Christianity. And then of course, some people promised that the reservations would continue. Reservations continue. So it is a kind of an identity statement, identity of defiance, distinctness. And then seeking respect, the status. So essentially, he looked at religion from a social point of view. Religion as a social point of view, as an identity, as a fight, as a self-assertion, as an equality, defiance, like that. He was not really much concerned about the metaphysics of Buddhism, spirituality of Buddhism. Okay. So he primarily thought in terms of identity. Okay, not metaphysics and spirituality. And of course, he used only an identity. He wasn't Ambedkar impressed by Buddha? Very much impressed. Moral factor, and more importantly, the way Buddha did not accept the most oppressive thing about Hinduism, that was casteism. So Buddha was definitely one of the earliest critics of Hinduism. And Buddha is being venerated in India. So Buddha is a part of the tradition and part of critic and popular. Already religion established, and so he thought it would serve the purpose. That was what. Because when Ambedkar said he would change, people from different religions came: Islam, Christians, Sikhs. But Ambedkar closely considered only two: Sikhism and Buddhism. And Ambedkar always had fascination for Buddha. He read a book on Buddha when he was a school, when he was in school. So Buddha had an impact on Ambedkar. And so finally he embraced Buddhism. But then he wanted a particular kind of religion where people would actively seek action and not renounce, meditate, and do things like that. So he wanted to make it a scientific and at the same time action-oriented, involving social change, fighting for equality. And he created a new religion. That's how we can explain and justify. So we looked at things from spirituality and metaphysics point of view. Ambedkar may have failed, but if you look at it in terms of social point of view, social purpose of religion, I think it is a bold step. That's how I look at it. I'm sure that more and more people are going to be Ambedkar at this. Okay. So from a social point of view, from values point of view, one can look at Ambedkar's step. And religion definitely should serve this purpose. So Ambedkar wanted action, liberty, equality, fraternity, and then scientific. And when he thought scientific, all these karmas, soul, rebirth, all thrown out. Okay. And when he wanted action, this desirelessness and things like that also are gone. So that was how Ambedkar devised his religion. And in this process, strangely, he is becoming a god. Okay. In many of the temples, Ambedkar statue also is there. Ambedkar statue is in a village as a defense and also is in a temple as a god. So this is how Buddhism in India is becoming redefined. Okay. So this is how we can understand. So when you are writing, when you are discussing social purpose of religion and change in Buddhism or the impact of Buddhism on Indian society, you can include Ambedkar. Ambedkar and Buddhism, you can take it as one of new forms of Buddhism. Okay, you can call it a cult. Yes, it can be called a cult. You can take this as an example of cult also. It's a cult. Of course, you can call it a sect also, because Buddhism anyway accepted, then you can call it a sect. You can call it a cult, you can call it a sect, new religion, social purpose. So you can use Ambedkarite Buddhism at many places in your answers, that is one. And discussing Ambedkarite Buddhism is also one way of discussing spiritual and metaphysical foundations of Buddhism, Jainism, and Hinduism. Any questions? We'll have one more class on Islam and link between Buddhism and Jainism and these things. And then we'll discuss religion, politics, interface, communalism,